फैकल्टी फॉर द सेशन संजय भाई, रीजनल काउंसिल मेंबर पुरुषोत्तम भाई खंडेलवाल, ट्रेजरर ऑफ द ब्रांच हरित भाई धारीवाल, कोऑर्डिनेटर्स फॉर टुडेज प्रोग्राम हर्ष भाई जानी, नीरव भाई अग्रवाल, सीनियर्स इन द प्रोफेशन, माय डियर फ्रेंड्स, अ वेरी गुड इवनिंग टू ऑल ऑफ यू। फ्रेंड्स, द टॉपिक इज सो रिलेवेंट एंड इम्पॉर्टेंट दैट द प्रेजेंस इटसेल्फ डेमोंस्ट्रेट इट्स। दिस नीड नॉट बी सब्सटेंशिएटेड बाय एनी अदर थिंग। फ्रेंड्स, फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल आई वुड रिक्वेस्ट the youngsters, especially the articles, because this program is not for the articles, for the members only, but if you have come, no problem, but please give the seats to the seniors or the elders, it is required. So I request you once again, please, if there are any articles, it is not disrespect to you, but please, for the sake of respect to the profession and to the, please offer your seats to the seniors, elders, or those who need it badly. We are also arranging the seats. Very soon, I believe, we will be able to accommodate maximum people that is possible. Initially, the program was planned in Santinath Auditorium, our branch auditorium, with 238 capacity. But when the response was being received, we thought it to move it somewhere else and to the nearest location of the branch. We also tried Sardar Patel Smarak with 1000 capacity, but unfortunately, that was booked. So we did not have that place with us. We did try with some other places also. But looking between so many constraints, we have to get the best one, and finally we could go for this with capacity of 525 sitting capacity. So I apologize for that, please bear with us. Friends, apart from that, I am very happy today to stand before you that for the entire year that has gone by, and now I am about to step down as a chairman in the few days to come, but we have been awarded as the best branch of the ICI. Friends, this is a matter of great pride for all of us to be part of this branch, and when in the large category, in the this mega category, when the branch has been awarded as the best branch, it means a lot, and it would not have been possible without the active support of all the committee members, various sub-committee members, the staff of the branch, and most important, last but not the least, all the members and the students who encourages us, who motivates us to do maximum programs. Friends, this is motivating me to have one more program on this particular topic, and I assure you, maybe in a day or two, with the availability of the faculty, we'll arrange another program so that those who have not been able to join us in this program can join and get benefited from this. But this program is being recorded and would be put on the website. Maybe I try by tomorrow itself, it will be available on the website so that you can view it later and can also be used or shared with your articles and staff also. Thank you. Without taking much of your time, now I request Nirav bhai to introduce our faculty. Thank you.
Thank you, Chairman sir. As such, the faculty requires no introduction. He is very famous and well-known speaker in this part of the country. C.A. Sanjay Vastupal Shah, he is continuously practiced since 1987. He is an FCA, company secretary, a member of American Institute of Certified Public Accountants. He is a DISA qualified, DISA IFRS. He stood first in Gujarat and fifth in India, and a gold medalist in Chartered Accountancy Final Examination in November 1987. He also stood first in Gujarat and 13th in India in his intermediate examination. He was first in Gujarat and third in India in his CS examination. He has delivered many lectures and contributed many articles at various levels in branch, association, study circles. He is a peer reviewer too. He is a faculty for certificate course of Concurrent Audit of Bank by ICI and have delivered more than 100 sessions across the country, including Mumbai, Pune, Nasik, Rajkot, Baroda, and Leicester. With this brief introduction and wasting, taking not much of your time, I request all of you to please welcome the faculty with a big round of applause. And I request CA Purushottam Khandelwal, sir, regional council member, to welcome the faculty with a bouquet and a memento. I request president of the branch, Haritha, to please join us to welcome the faculty.
The team Ahmedabad for getting the BAME branch award, you know, and it is a matter of pride, and I am sure that you deserve everybody. And thank you everybody for, you know, coming to the last number. And you know, basically, let us straight away come to the point without taking much of the time. As you know, that exactly before 3 months, on the 8th of November, you know, today is the 7th February, there is almost 3 months down the line. So today, we are having that period of 3 months, and today now we have to respond. The reply to the kind of the questions or the queries asked by the Income Tax Department. Today's session is basically restricted mainly to how to respond to the notices received on the cash deposits, right? And in view of this, you know, limited time, we'll be restricting only on the methodology, computation, and everything pertaining to the response to be given for the cash deposits. One disclaimer, these all the views expressed here are the personal views. And all the chartered accountants, I am sure that all the members are very intelligent, are required to use their own discretion and intelligence and define based on the case to case, so that, you know, because everything will differ and depend on the actual situation. So, going by that thing, see, as we all know, that initial phase of the operation clean money is involving the e-verification large cash deposits from 9th November to 30th of December. And lot of data analysis have been used for getting the information based on the data received. And you know, I am not surprised, there has been a system in place, and very rightly, the notices have been received for the first 18 lakhs of the SMEs or the users who are supposed to be having not, you know, proper source of the cash. As you are all aware, that the initial phase contains of the 18 lakh SSCs identified out of the population of 125 crores. Those who have the amount of the cash deposited in the bank account and not matching the So, and what is the profile? That is not known to us. But as of today, we believe that, you know, there would have been some data analysis and some techniques used to find out based on the various criteria like the income tax return, the amount of the income declared in the last few years, and the amount of the transactions, the regularity of the return deposit, since how many years they have been depositing, the nature of business, are various criteria. And based on this, there's been the one thing very surprisingly, or maybe there may be some logic behind it. What has been asked to the total cash deposit from 9th November to 30th December, right? So I believe most of us were expecting the explanation for the SBL in respect of the 9th November to 30th December. But here, the explanation is to be given for all the cash deposits between 9th November to 30th December. So it is like a question paper, we have to reply the way in which the question has been asked, correct? So basically, I am going to explain you how best we need to do it. And as I told you, we have to use our discretion before attempting to respond to the same. Another thing that, you know, this everything is online, and the taxpayer will be able to submit the response online, and if the response is found satisfactory, they will be eliminated from the very first round. So maybe out of the 18 lakhs, few lakhs SSCs will be chosen or selected to go further, and a second round of query may come to them. Again, it will come by email only, and the response to that also will have to be submitted electronically only. And only then, after if the case is further selected for the scrutiny, then the need for visiting the department or explanation of publishing the necessary document or paper may arise. But my word of precaution to all of you is that please do not underestimate anything or anyone. We have to be very clear, and we have to be prepared that whatever explanation we are submitting at this point of time we should be able to justify it till the last point of time, even if selected for the final scrutiny. Correct? Now, as you all know, that how to view the information. It is basically, once you log in into your e-filing Income Tax India, I think everybody is fully aware of it, right? So you log in that, then there is a one section which is, you know, like compliance, and there you can find out CAT transaction 2016. Now here, even if suppose if a person has not received email or SMS, it is better to select the login and go into and find out whether this kind of the query exists or not. Because in few cases where either email have not been updated properly or mobile number is not correct, it is possible that the message might not have gone. But one thing is certain, the department has given all the messages and emails all at a time on a single go to all the SSCs. And I think that it is a one of the very good example of the technical advancement. There is no question of anything, you know, and find that the data given is also matching or the correct. We will see that again. Now what is the scenario is that once you will log in and you find the query, there will be two options. One will be the details of the bank where they have given the bank, bank account, transactions, and you know, how, what kind of the has been given. Now here the response will have to be submitted basically once we confirm that the account relates to the given PAN number only. Correct? Now let us go to the other part. We will come back to the first part later. Because it will involve a lot of issues. The second part pertains to the fact that the account does not relate to the given PAN number. This is a case of the incorrect reporting. Correct? So, suppose in case where the data given is not belonging to the account holder of the PAN number, then the SSC has to select the option that this account does not relate to the PAN number. But I would suggest you to be very careful before selecting this option, because it means that either the bank account or the bank who has furnished or done the reporting is having the PAN number in their records as the master data. So probably one has to be very careful and double check that how and in what situation the data given is not pertaining to the account number of the given PAN holder. Now suppose a person selects the account related to this particular PAN. Here what happens, that if we agree, then we go to the second situation. Now, suppose if we say that the account belongs to the PAN number, but the value of the cash deposit is not correct. Say for example, a person has deposited 10 lakhs of rupees and the data given is of 11 lakhs of rupees. It means that the value given is not correct. Then the SSC has to select the option that the account belongs to the given PAN number, and then there is an option of mentioning the correct amount of the cash deposit, and then SSC can defer to the amount reported. But here also the particular difference will be taken with the particular bank or the reporting basis. So what will happen, that if there is a situation where there is a dispute between the bank account holder and the bank, it is advisable to have the communication with the bank. Probably one should write a registered email letter to the bank explaining that, you know, in my particular account number the reporting has been done in a wrong manner. I have deposited actually this much account amount in this much account number, while the reporting says that you have reported this much amount against my PAN number. So probably you should address that kind of communication to the branch as well as to the higher authority and keep that record with you, because subsequently it is possible that that may be a situation of the dispute, because that situation will now only come to know that what has actually happened and how it is being dealt with.
Sir, the certain banks have reported the cash deposited on 8th November.
That is wrong.
Therefore, this difference arises.
Correct.
So, why to write to the bank?
Correct.
Now, it is quite clear that only reporting is to be made for cash deposit between 9th to 30th.
Okay, we will take up the situation separately, but I have taken care of the same. We will just go one by one. See, now there can be couple of issues. One is that error or mistake of the reporting line. Now here we need to have a bank statement copy, the counter paying slips of the cash deposited. Because suppose if the bank says that, you know, there is an amount of difference, If your statement does not reflect the particular amount of the cash deposit, then obviously you are correct. There is no problem. But make sure that you have the latest copy of the statement and the counterfoil of the cash deposit. In many of the banks, what has happened, that on particular day, a person has gone to withdraw the cash. For some or other reason, the check has been entered, the amount has been debited. But when the actual payment of the cash came, the bank people said that we don't have the cash. Now they cannot reverse the entry, because we know that in the Finacle or any bank accounting package, it is not possible to reverse the entry. So what the bank people have done, they have requested the account holder to go for the cash deposits. So actually there is no cash transaction. But on, let us say, 15th of November, there is a cash withdrawal of 49,000, and against which there is a cash deposit of 49,000, right? But once that transaction has been done by the bank, we have to explain that in our course of the action. Then we can take the help of the cash withdrawal of the same date and offer it for the particular reason also. Second situation is a situation where joint account, where the PAN number is of the first holder, it is not available with the bank for any reason. Either the form number 60 was given or the account was opened earlier, and the PAN number of the second holder is available with the branch or the bank. The bank has reported the transaction in the second holder account. Now here what happens? The query is going to the second account holder, correct? So what will happen? The second account holder will have to either come up and say that yes, this account relates to this PAN number, but I am a second holder account and this entire transactions belong to the first holder, and we have to give the full details of the first holder including the PAN number if available. That is one way. Another and the better option can be that straight away go and explain the cash deposits in that particular manner only, so that probably same can be eliminated outright. Right? Third, let us say joint accounts, where the transactions are reported in the PAN number of the first holder, but the transactions are accounted for or offered for the income in the second holder. We know that in many accounts, let us say husband and wife or joint holders, the transactions belong to the second holder. Let us say A and B, the check issued in the favor of B has been deposited in the account of joint account of A and B. Now that money has been withdrawn or deposited, whatever. So now that transaction is reported as the PAN number of the first holder, correct? And actually it belongs to the second holder. So here also what happens, the first holder has to come forward and say that yes, this transaction belonging to the account where PAN number is furnished. However, these transactions are being offered or accounted for by the second holder, and the PAN number of the second holder is such and such date. Now here the issue is that, can the first holder mention the fact of the transaction belonging to second holder and still explain the source of cash deposit, or can the first holder afford to disown the transactions by referring the same to the second order PAN number? Say for example, the joint holders, they don't have access to the books of account of each other theoretically. So the first holder will say that yes, this transaction taken place in my account, but the liability or the accounting for which is going to be done by the second holder. So in that case what will happen, the trigger will go to the second holder ideally. But if the second holder fails to furnish the enough explanation, then the exponent again comes back to the first holder, correct? So the risk has to be decided by the first holder, whether he wants to take that risk of not offering the explanation or wants to go for complete explanation and still mention the fact that the transaction will be accounted by the second holder. Third, there are some cases where duplicate or double reporting by the banks. For example, in the cases of the merger of the banks, we know some banks have been merged in between. In those cases, what has happened, that the reporting has been done by the erstwhile entity also, and also done by the merged entity. So there is a duplicate reporting. But here also, there is no problem. The SSC has to say that yes, this particular transactions are duplicate, repeated, and he has to offer explanation for only one set of transactions. Now again, there can be, you know, one more issue which is not important right now but may come up in future. In many cases, what has happened, that the account holder has deposited legal notes. You know the meaning of the SBN, right? SBN stands for the specified bank notes of 500,000 rupee notes which have been demonetized. Now, some of the banks by mistakes have reported the legal not reported as SVN reported. Now this fact cannot be identified at this point of time based on the data available on the portal. Are you getting me? Because here they are asking about the total case reports, right? But it is better that we need to be clear that whatever SVNs have been deposited should be separately identified, tallied with the counterfoil, and in most of the cases, banks have already, you know, mentioned in the bank statement as a SVN. So if you go and if you found that there is a cash deposit with the amount mentioning SVN in the reported column, and where the SVN has not been deposited, then immediately one has to rush to the bank and tell to the bank that this is a wrong reporting and actually it is a legal not, not the SVN. And probably necessary certificate or the letter has to be obtained from the bank. It will not be possible for the bank, or it may not be possible for the bank to correct or rectify the same. But for the account holder, it is always advisable, and bank have to offer necessary explanation in terms of the certificate that yes, this is a mistake, it is actually legal not and have been offered as a SVN. Because tomorrow in the second step, when the detail of the SVN will be called for, at that time this will become a relevant factor. Now, there is a third part. Once we go for the bank account, let us say we have confirmed that there are two accounts where the cash have been deposited and the amount is matching and we are going to give the response. Now there is a line that in addition to above, you know, click here to give the details of the other banks where the SPN have been deposited. Now here, mind well, the details have to be furnished only in respect of the SPN. Correct? So it means that on the date on which you are submitting the response, if the bank details given pertain to only some of the bank account, then you need to furnish the detail of the additional bank where the SVN have been deposited. But there also make sure that you furnish only for the SVN. While for the banks where there has been reported, we have to furnish actually for the total cash deposit. Correct? So this is the difference between two. And again, mind well, this is a dynamic portal. This information keeps on changing and updated every on the real-time basis. So it is quite possible, today when you log in, you find that there is only two information. Tomorrow you will find that there is a third account also. So probably, today you think that, okay, now we have to give the report only for the SVN in respect of the bank account where it is not given. But by the time you go and submit the response, if it is already included in the above first portion, then the expense will be given for the total cash deposit. Correct? So this one has to keep into the mind. Now, here, as I told you, it is important that details in case pertain to the SVN only and not in relation to total cash deposits. Now, once we come to the area where we agree that the account number belongs to the particular user, the amount of the cash deposit matches with the total amount of the cash displayed, then we have to come to the stage where we have to explain the amount of the cash deposits, right? Now here it is a bit tricky area. It appears very simple. But I would suggest you to please do proper exercise to do enough working of the Excel sheet, and where you feel that it is better to go for the proper books of account and then only go for the reporting. For the sake of convenience, now onwards I am going to divide the present in two parts. One for those who are maintaining the regular books of account, and secondly for those who have not maintained the regular books of account. Correct? Because probably the methodology differs in both the cases. Now, these are the explanations of the transaction. We all know that bank IFSC code, account number, cash deposit between 9th November and 30th December, cash deposit in the account between 9th November and 30th December, right? Now, further, you know, like somebody asked me that, you know, deposit of 8th number, I think one has to disagree here and mention here only the amount which is between 9th and 30th. Please don't accept anything which doesn't belong to you. So that is that. Now there can be seven possibilities of these sources. One, cash out of the earlier income or the savings. Now it means that we have to see what it means. There are a lot of, you know, in the general parlance, there's a different meaning for the cash deposited out of the earlier savings or income. Second option is cash out of the receipt exempted from the tax, which includes agricultural income, gift or any other exempt income. Cash withdrawn out of the bank account. Fourth, received from the identifiable person with PAN number. Fifth, identifiable person without PAN number. Cash received from unidentifiable person. The last category is cash disclosed under Prime Minister Garib Kalyan Yojana. So the total of the seven has to match with the amount of the cash deposited. So when you submit the response, the balance has to be basically zero. You cannot leave it into the surplus or it cannot be negative. Correct? So make sure that you do this exercise first before you submitting your response. The response can be one or more multiple of one or all seven combination of this. Correct? Now, as we know that what is the explanation of the cash transaction? Suppose the amount displayed under A4 is not correct, right? Then we have to mention the correct amount. That means if the amount is not matching as the record, we have to mention the correct amount. And then we need to offer the explanation for the amount which we have accepted. Assuming that the difference amount is a error or the mistake of the reporting bank or the institution, right? If the cash is from more than one category, then source may be assigned under various categories. Nothing wrong, it can be all seven as well. If cash is claimed to be out of the earlier income or savings, further detail can be provided in the remarks. Cash is claimed to be out of the receipt exempted from the tax, like agriculture income or anything, further detail can be provided under the remarks. In case the amount received a donation, gift or loan, then also the details can be divided into the real case may be. Then in case the cash is received from the other person, nature of the cash transaction, that is cashless, gift, etc., can be mentioned while providing the detail under B4, B5, B6. We will go into the detail, you know what it means. Some of the old sources have to match with the cash before it, so that the balance is zero. Now this is a screenshot of what is going to be the screen. I am sure that you all have a look at it. So let us go further. Again, this is the second part of the A, B, C, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, and the total. Now, we have to keep certain points in the mind, like one is that in case where the cash deposit amount displayed before is not correct, then department will refer the cases back to the information sources. So it means that immediately, based on your submitted response, the email or the inquiry will go to the reporting bank. And they will be required to submit their response within a particular time frame. So if the bank corrects that response, then you are fine. And that is I am telling you that please also communicate with the bank so that bank is aware when the query comes to them also. Otherwise what will happen, bank will only reconfirm the return submitted earlier. So again the ball will come to the our court. And again the same situation will come. And unnecessarily the case may be put up for the scrutiny. Because if suppose two parties do not agree and do not come to a conclusion, there will be a situation where someone has to intervene and decide who is right or who is wrong. Then here what will happen, that all the seven categories return out of the bank, we have to use B3, identifiable person B4, identifiable person without bank B5, unidentifiable B6, exempted income B2, earlier income B1 and B7.
Sir,
yeah.
I'm coming to that.
Now, again, if there are multiple entries, B2 through facilities provided for online submission as well as upload of the CSV, comma separated value. So it is only a computer sort of programming where the detail furnished, like Excel sheet, one will prepare the Excel sheet for it will be converted. Utility has been given on the site, so you have to download the utility, apply it and furnish or you know, convert the given Excel file into CSV file and then you can upload the same. So that is a simple, you know, like when you do the e-filing, we keep on uploading the various data. Now, when the amount is claimed to be withdrawn out of the bank account, account-wise details are required to be provided. Here, we did not give the date-wise details. What is required is only the bank account number, IFSC code and the amount withdrawn. So probably one can mention in one row, give the name of the bank, branch or the IFSC code, amount withdrawn, and then you can put in the remark that the amount withdrawn from such date to so and so date.
Sir,
huh?
amount withdrawn before 1st of April.
Yeah, I am coming to that. Okay. Now, cash is received from other person on account of cancelled loan, gift, donation, it should be mentioned under B456 and claim to be out of the receipt exempted should be mentioned into this thing. Now, I think, again, this is basically the same thing. Let us go to the, you know, important part. Now, we come to the, you know, where everybody is very eager how to compute the cash, right? Basically, I would suggest that total cash deposit should be explained as a whole. But considering the accounting aspect, income tax part, legal aspect, and to meet with the logical intent of the government, it is advisable to bifurcate the total cash deposit into the SBN deposits and legal non-deposits. Mind well, today it is not asked separately, but it is necessary, and I will explain you why it is necessary also. Now, we will go to the first part, where the SSDs are maintained in the regular books of account. Now, this can be situation where the cash on hand balance as on 31st March 2016 has been reported. Now, how and where it can be reported? One, SS is covered under tax for it. So, obviously, your cash on hand balance as on 31st March 2016 is already uploaded, available. Second situation, the filing of the ITR in form number 4. Because we know that form number 4 is for the income from business and professions, and there you have to do the financial detail uploading, which includes the balance sheet and profit and loss account. So there, probably the balance sheet would have already mentioned the amount of cash on hand. So that figure is already reflected or reported there, correct? Third situation, 4S, presumptive taxation. Even the SSEs who are going for the presumptive taxation, they are also required to report certain items in the ITR form. So there also they have already reported. Then, SSE who have the reported the figure of cash in hand is scheduled AL, SSN liability, where it is mandatory in the cases where the total income exceeds rupees 50 lakhs. And SSE who have reported figures of the cash on hand to any other government agency in compliance of any other requirement, anywhere, whether income tax department, VAT, excise, import duty, whatever. And SSE covered under search or survey. Now, in my opinion, these all SSEs are the SSEs where the cash on hand on 31st March 2016 is frozen. You agree? In my opinion, there is no way we can dispute it. I mean, generally, yes, you can revise the return technically, but in the general terms, that figure of cash on hand is frozen. So, I presume, and my logic is that we have to start working from that date point onwards. We'll go further how it means.
Today, we have to report only those cash which are not reported in P&L or balance
sheet. We'll come to that in second part also. This is basically we are referring to those cases where cash on hand has already been reported, reflected.
So, both can enter. If we buy a cash on hand in balance sheet, that is my business.
Yes. Yeah, correct. So whatever has been reported, correct. Basically, whatever has been reported, you need to combine both the, you need to aggregate or whatever, right? Or somebody can say that in case of the proprietary firm, for example, audit is done for the firm, an individual is maintaining another books of account, for example, right? There also can be a situation where the cash on hand reported is the tax audit are different. But normally, when you will report in the income tax return, it will be a combination of both the cash on hand. Correct? But depending upon the fact, you have to take the balance of 1st April 2016, which is a frozen. It's a cut-off point. I'm coming to that. Please bear with me. Because later, then I'm telling you. Please, we'll have the question answer later on. Absolutely. And secondly, I am going to cover everything logically. So let us first of all go through it, and then we'll have at least 1 hour for the question answer session. Now, some of the basis of the explanation. We can say they are the assumptions. Is that all the cash receipts, that means including cash withdrawn from the bank or payment or purchase whatever, have been recorded properly. There is a presumption. I mean, you have to make sure. It may be an advisable situation to go and do the audit of the books of account. I would take it as a professional opportunity as well. And then you come to a situation where 1st April to 30th December is already been audited or sort of, you know, you can say that reliable books of account. Then all the cash payment, including cash deposited in the banks, are properly recorded. And third, cash book is maintained properly or cash transactions are recorded with proper supporting and evidence. Unless these things are taken care of, it may not be possible to substantially justify the amount of the cash deposit. Now, coming to the SBN deposited. Now, we are dividing the entire thing into two parts. First, SBN, second is the legal norms. For the SBN, which have deposited on or after 9th November, the explanation can be only prior to the 9th November. You agree? There cannot be explanation for any source for the period after 8th November. Right? So what will happen? One has to do that reconciliation. What is the opening balance of 1st April 2016? Then add cash received during the period 1st April to 8th November 2016. We can add cash withdrawn from the bank during 1st April to 8th November 2016, less cash deposited during 1st April to 8th November, less cash paid, purchase or expenses incurred during 1st April to 8th November, is equal to the closing cash balance, both SBN and legal, because till the end of the 8th November, it was only one cash balance. Only after 8th November, it is bifurcated into two parts, SBN and legal notes. Correct? Now, secondly, SBN deposited after 8th November cannot be more than the amount of the cash balance in hand as computed above at the end of the 8th November 2016. Right? You all agree? It cannot be more than the balance as on 8th November 2016. In case if the SBN deposited exceeds the amount of the cash on hand balance on 8th of November, then the SSC has to think for the option of going for the Prime Minister Garib Kalyan Yojana. Now, this is a sort of the chart which I think would explain most of the scenarios. Let me tell you what is happening. My logic is very simple. For the SBN, we need to go on the reverse FIFO basis for the period prior to 6th November 2016. Correct? That means, suppose if I have deposited 10 lakhs of rupees anytime after 9th November in SBN, I need to work it out or I need to explain it from my either cash balance on 8th November or go reverse as back as I have to in order to match my total SBN deposit. Correct? So what it means? Suppose I have a balance of 1st April 2016, whatever, X amount, 5 lakhs, 2 lakhs, 10 lakhs. Then there is a cash receipt between 1st April and 8th November 2016. Correct? Now this balance at the end of the 8th November 2016 will be then divided into two parts, SBN as well as legal. Now this balance of SBN, if I have to explain that how did I acquire those SBN, then I have to go on the reverse basis. In my opinion, even if you take any other basis, there are all the chances that one may not be able to justify it correctly. Let us go into the detail. What will happen? Suppose my balance as on 8th November is 2 lakhs of rupees and I have deposited 10 lakhs. So then I have to go on my cash sales or cash receipt 8th November, 7th November, 6th November, 5th November, go as back as you have to. Till the period 1st April 2016. You cannot go beyond that because 1st April your cash on hand balance is frozen. Correct? So all your cash receipt between 1st April and 8th November will be eligible for SBN. But here, mind well, as I told you, two conditions. Cash balance should never go into the negative as per your cash book. Because if the cash balance at any point of time is going into negative, then there are chances that it will create a problem. Right? So, if you are maintaining the cash on hand balance, cash book, which is not having a negative balance at any point of time, then you can safely go by this working. And then this working will be logical accountingly, mathematically, arithmetically, income tax point of view also will justify all your cash receipts. Correct? Now coming to the legal matters, because whether intentionally or unintentionally, we have to also explain the sources for the legal notes. So there we have to go on two parts. Suppose if there is a surplus balance on 8th of November, where suppose if my balance is ₹5 lakhs, and I have deployed only ₹4 lakhs. So I can claim that I have 1 lakh as on 8th November, which can be used for explaining the legal note deposits on or after 9th November, because right now we have to explain the total amount of the cash deposit. Secondly, my cash receipt between 9th November and 30th December can also be used. So here I have to use a FIFO method. FIFO meaning thereby, my cash receipt on 9th November should be taken first, my cash receipts of 10th November should be taken first, then 11th November, then 12th November. Go as forward as you have to match with the amount of cash deposited. So ideally, what will happen, my explanation period for the cash deposit can be, let us say theoretically, 15th of July 2016 till 15th of December 2016. Correct? Am I clear? This is very important, because for adapting any other working, there can be a many formulas of working. But you have to make sure that otherwise, suppose if one person takes the cash withdrawal on 5th of May and would explain that this is my cash withdrawal on 5th of May. Correct? Legally, it is correct. But then technically, if your balance any date after 5th of May is less than 1 lakh of rupees, so your answer becomes wrong from the income tax point of view. Are you getting me? So we have to make sure that the explanation for the SBN has to be done on the reverse working, sort of a LIFO basis. The last receipt to be considered first for explaining the SBN. And for the legal notes, you have to go on the FIFO method from 9th November onwards. So for every SSE, there can be one period which can comprise of the period from 1st April to 30th December, or any date between 1st April to 8th November, and any date between 9th November to 30th December. So if this is the way of explanation, it would, I think, logically also meet the requirement. And tomorrow, if further questions are asked in respect of the SBN, then also we would be in a position to explain the same. Let us go to the examples. Now here are some of the examples which, you know, I thought we can do. Theoretically, let us take a situation where on 1st of April the cash balance is 5 lakhs. Assuming there are no transactions in between the year, and my cash on hand is 8th November 5 lakhs. Correct? Here in this situation, the explanation can be earlier income or savings V1. Because my cash balance has been reported somewhere, so I can safely rely. I need not go back prior to 31st March, because it has already been accounted for and it is on the record of the income tax department. Correct? So I can say that it is out of my earlier income or savings. Secondly, it should be mentioned in the remark column that cash on end of 5 lakhs is as per the either latest audit balance sheet or as per the income tax return filed, or as per the tax audit report, whatever be the case, so that it can be linked with the particular fact which we are reporting. Correct? Okay. Now, normally in this scenario, the SSE should not have deposited an SPN more than 5 lakhs of rupees. In case the SPN report exceeds 5 lakhs, then again SSE has to go for the option of Prime Minister Garib Kalyan Yojana. Okay. Now we'll go to the second example. Let us take a second scenario where there is an opening balance, zero. On 5th of May, there is a cash sales of 5 lakhs of rupees. The same balance is being carried forward as on 8th November. Here what will happen, that the explanation can be cash sales from, again, there will be three scenarios. Cash sales from the persons who are identifiable with PAN number, one option. Persons identifiable without PAN number. and the third person unidentifiable. So appropriate category has to be chosen. Now here, see, there are going to be some very interesting scenario. What is the meaning of the identifier? If you go by the Oxford Dictionary or the legal meaning of identifier, it means a person should be capable of being identified with the records available with the SSC. Correct? Now, say for example, let us take a case of an hospital where the patients are admitted and they have given the cash, same has been deposited bank account. Now there is a practice that, you know, they are depositing the entire cash collection in the next working day to the bank. There is a proper system of the patient record, there is a software, everything is available. Sometimes even their x-ray, their diagnostic report, everything is available, correct? Persons are fully identifiable, correct? But they don't have the PAN number, right? So they would fall into the category of the persons identifiable but without PAN number, correct? Now going to the category where, suppose if we take another example of, let us say, a take of the photo in a photo studio where a person goes, gets, you know, certain photograph, passport photograph done, and he pays the money. Now that photography studio also deposits the cash regularly in the bank account. Correct? Mind well, here we are not focusing on SBN or the black money. We are only talking about the normal business transaction. Now what will happen in this scenario? Can that businessman say that persons are identifiable because he has a photograph negative in the software or the data, right? He can say that, you know, this person came and I have the proof. But for this particular purpose of reporting, it will be called as a unidentifiable. Because the moment you say they are identifiable, they have to give name, address, PIN code and amount, correct? So what happens? That unless you have an address as well as a PIN code, one cannot venture to go into this scenario. There can be a situation that out of the 100 cases, probably 5 cases address may be incomplete or PIN code may not be available. So I would say that then a person can take a call and furnish the detail of entire 100 people in the CSV template, correct? But then you have to mention the address definitely. Now whether mentioning only Ahmedabad would be enough? Suppose if I mention only Ahmedabad in the address column, is it enough? Technically or electronically the same can be transmitted. Because, I mean, nobody can define how many characters or whether alphanumerical. You cannot validate any field based on the address criteria.
PIN code is given as a separate field.
Yeah, PIN code is a separate field, correct? So again, you have to make sure that you give the details in the best possible manner. So whatever, you know, your period. So what will happen in those kind of the business, we have to take the period and furnish the detail of the cases of 5th May. Give the person-wise or the bill number-wise details. Again, in case of the details of persons unidentifiable, what should be? Let us say example of the retail outlet or some of the cash counter or some of the, you know, restaurant, fast food parlor where they have been accepting the cash from the customers regularly and depositing the bank account. Persons may not be identified, correct? They have got two options. They can afford to go and mention the aggregate amount of cash collected as a cash sales and mention as a one row item. But the better option is to go even on certain data, date wise, bill number wise data, let there be 1000 entries. You know, basically, suppose if there is a scrutiny and they will ask the data, we are going to provide the data, right? So let there be the, you know, you can take the Excel, any software you can generate and convert into the Excel file, convert into the Excel file, and then convert into the CSV file. So take the data either date wise or bill number wise and then convert it into the CSV file and upload it on the website. Again in the remarks column, there will be three different scenarios. If you say the persons are identifiable with PAN number, then in the remark column, one has to mention that what is the nature of business, so that why cash has been accepted from the person. Usually, one can say that we are running into a business of so-and-so, where the amount of per bill or the per transaction is ideally less than 10-20,000. And hence the cash have been accepted from the customer, though it is not mandatory. But if it is practical, you should link it with the nature of business. In the scenario where persons identifiable without PAN number, one has to give the details more correctly and specify that yes, persons are identifiable, name, address, PIN code number is as per the data available with the record of the SSC. Again, mind well, this sort of disclaimer has to be there, that the information is as per the record available with the SSC, because SSC cannot vouch for the genuineness of the data. Today a person has come and given some details, right? So I am furnishing the details which is available as per my records. But my records are the details available. And also mention the nature of business. And also explain that there is no requirement, there is no mandatory requirement to obtain the PAN number. And hence PAN number has not been obtained. Correct? This is the second scenario. Third scenario of cash sales, where from the unidentified persons. This scenario, one has to be very careful, because more likely that this scenario may be later on taken up for the scrutiny. Not necessarily, but depending upon the fact of the case. So here one has to mention the nature of business in detail, that you know the SSC is into the retail business or having the cash counter of so and so. Since last 5 years, 10 years, whatever, the SSC is regularly now having the practice of depositing the cash collected into the bank account at regular or predetermined interval. If it is a practice to deposit very next day, you should mention that usually the cash collected is deposited very next day. And in case if it is not done so, then you can say that the cash is deposited at regular intervals. And then also mention that having regard to the nature of the business, it is not practical to obtain the name, address or other details of the person. Or at the most you can say that it is possible or SSC have the record of the name, but the address is not available or the PIN code is not available. Correct? And hence you are falling into this category. So you need to give better explanation, proper reasoning for the cash received from the unidentified person, because this is a potential dangerous source of cash.
Sir, can I ask a very relevant question regarding this? Can we not classify it under the first B1, that cash out of earlier income or savings? Because vis-a-vis on 8th, it is my saving or okay, it is my out of previous earning. So can I not report it under the B1?
Sir, I agree with you. Here, as I told you, they have not specified what is the meaning of the earlier. Whether they mean 1st April, whether they mean 8th November, or what is the cutoff date, right?
But they want that information between the 9th and 30th. Okay. The logically, if we go logically, then what is the position as on 8th, closing of the 8th?
Correct. If so in that scenario, what will happen? Most of the people will only report that out of my earlier sales of income. Yes. Because all the SBNs are prior to the 8th November. Yes. Correct?
But
tell me one thing in that case. Can there be any other explanation if I accept that argument that my balance of 8th November, then everybody will fall into that category. It is out of my earlier savings and income.
No, total deposit is more than what is on the 8th. The total deposit more, he has to apply.
If it is more than you to go, the Prime Minister Garib Rozgar. There is no question.
It's not like that, what I say, that in between, say, as on 8th, I have got cash on hand of 5 lakh. I have deposited 7 lakh. But it may happen that during the in between sale, I might have deposited new notes. So I have to explain it.
Sir, that is, I told you, we need to give breakup.
I need to give breakup. But so far as the 5 lakh is concerned, as on 8th November, I can show it on the B1 because it is out of saving as on 8th November.
Okay. I think we'll take up later. Let us continue with what we are doing.
previous income and previous receipt.
That's all the businesses have been legitimately permitted to do so. They can do that. Those who have been permitted legally, like petrol pump or government hospital or those people, they can afford to do so. Yeah. But even for that, this kind of working will have to be done.
They have said
I think let us keep the question after little later, because otherwise what will happen that, you know, we'll lose the game, right? Sorry for that. See, okay. So then we go to the third example. Let us say opening balance is zero and cash withdrawn from the bank is 5 lakhs of rupees on 6th of June. And the same is reflected as my closing balance. Then the correct option would be cash withdrawn from the bank, B3. And there we'll mention the name of the bank, account number, IFSC code, and the amount withdrawn. And the remark column you can say that yes, the amount has been withdrawn in one single instance or on such and such date, or you can give that is agreed with my cash withdrawal from this bank account from this period to this period. Again here, if the amount is more than that, then you have to be offered for the Prime Minister Garib Kalyan. Okay. Now we'll go to the another example where there is a combination. Let us be slightly careful here. Say, my opening balance is 5 lakhs of rupees on 1st of April. My cash receipt, which includes cash sales or any other receipt, for the period from, 5th April here, for example, is 2 lakhs. 8th June, bank withdrawn 1 lakh. Out of which on 7th April, I have deposited 1 lakh into the bank. 10th July cash expense of 1 lakh, resulting into the balance of 6 lakhs from 8th of November. This will be the situation of most of the people, right? Here the figure will come into an aggregate of some odd number or whatever, the total, correct? Now what will happen? Assuming out of 6 lakhs, entire cash has been deposited of 6 lakhs, right? Expense can be divided into 3 parts. 1. First, in the same order, logical. First, cash withdrawal from the bank of 1 lakh in B3. Because going by the LIFO method, you come to that last withdrawal is available with you out of 6 lakhs. Correct? So physically, even if you go by any logic, one can very well argue that the balance lying on 8th November was comprising of at least this cash which was withdrawn on 8th of June. So my first explanation would be 8th June, a B3 of 1 lakh of bank withdrawal. Second, cash receipt of 2 lakhs. So cash receipt of 2 lakhs will fall into B4 to B6. That means again identifiable person with PAN, without PAN or unidentified person. Correct? Third, earlier income or savings to the extent of the required. Here 3 lakhs. Because out of 5, 3 were lying in stock as on 8th of November. So 3 lakhs will be represented into B1. So in my opinion, in most of the situation, this can be the combination of the reply of the source of deposits. Correct? Once again, we have to go based on the LIFO formula, or you can take a reverse of the FIFO. Because otherwise what will happen, it may happen that the bank withdrawal of June were later on utilized, resulting into a lower balance on 15th of June. So in order to avoid that situation, it is advisable to go on the LIFO. If you will go on the LIFO basis, you will never come up with a problem of negative cash or shortage of the cash. Correct? Again, if one has deposited more than 6 lakhs of rupees, then SS has to go for the Prime Minister's Gariha.
A very important point in case of bank withdrawal, where your explanation may not hold water, is if the withdrawal has been done in smaller denomination notes and not 500 and 1000.
Okay, that's
because
a good
that
point.
Detail is correct. Available with the bank.
Okay, now what will happen? Here, assuming that that is happened, that you have withdrawn the bank and the withdrawal was in the legal tender, other than SBN. And the same has been deposited by virtue of the SBN, right? Here, I think that it is a case of the judgment which one had to take. Assuming that theoretically and legally, if you can bifurcate or they are aware. See, most of the times what will happen, SSC will not be aware in what denomination cash was withdrawn. Correct? In the regular bank account, when you are withdrawing 50,000, you don't know whether you receive 100 rupee note, 500 rupee note or what. So, if you really go into that situation, you have to confirm with the bank, first of all, that whether they have the data and what data they are giving.
So let us
conclude that if that data is available, then only you have to go for it. Otherwise, you can afford to explain the cash on hand of 8th November with the necessary thing. Okay, but have you understood this particular way of ordering? And the order is also very important. Okay. Now, this was for the SSCs who maintain the regular books of account or who are having cash on hand reflected anywhere and maintain the regular books of account, right? Now, assuming that in this particular example, do you have any other question? Because I think let us have that particular thing here. Any other situation that you can envisage us and how we can order?
See, totally the person has got 8 lakhs which has come in.
Correct.
Okay. Now the money that is held at the end, which is 6 lakhs in the example. Suppose he has deposited 6 lakhs. You cannot point a finger that this out of the 6 lakhs deposited, I can maintain that 5 lakhs was out of my opening balance.
Yeah, I agree. But
money doesn't have a different shape.
But I agree. But the point is, on 7th of April, there is the outflow of the cash. Correct? So if I take here bank table of 3, for example, then what will happen?
No,
are you getting me?
No, I am only going by your example that your outflow is of 2 lakhs.
Correct.
So you can explain that 6 lakhs deposited is opening balance 5 and cash withdrawn 1.
Correct. Provided the date of 5th April.
We are only going by the example.
Exactly. I agree with you.
Not trying to prove you wrong.
But I agree with you. But suppose here, in the real life, what will happen? There will be multiple countries. So, assuming that 5th April becomes 15th April or anywhere in between the transition, then it can be right. So, that is why I told you the very simple example.
Daily cash balance
given. I think let us focus on this particular idea. So I agree that if this is the scenario and one can afford to say that my 6 lakh is out of 4 lakh out of opening balance or 2 lakh out of cash withdrawal, correct? Can we take it later on? Okay. Now we'll come to the second part. Now second part is for the SSCs. Who are not covered in the part 1. It means that those who have not reflected or reported their cash on hand, who did not get their account audited, who were not required to file the return in ITR 4 or 4S, or who did not report cash on hand elsewhere. So it means that their cash on hand figure as on 1st April 2015 has not been reported anywhere. Correct? So in my opinion, probably they can afford to go even for the period prior to 1/4/16. How? What this kind of the people may include either salary employees, retired employees, senior citizens, or other SSCs not carrying on any business profession, or those who are not maintaining regular books of account. For those, we can go for a simple methodology, or we can simply derive a formula. Let us see how it works. This kind of an SSC has an option of going beyond the period prior to 1/16 as well. Because since it is not reported, that figure is not frozen. Correct? So we can go even prior. Now, they may offer the cash withdrawal out of the bank account even prior to the period of 1/4/16. because it is not reported. So one can say that out of the 5 lakhs, I withdrew 2 lakhs on 17th of July 2015, 1 lakh on 1st January 2016, 1 lakh on 15th April 2016. Correct? So this kind of, if you can have the concrete instances of cash withdrawal from the bank, then it is advisable to report that. But again, one has to be careful. For what? Necessary adjustment have to be made for the following. One, cash deposited into the bank account after the relevant cash withdrawal from the bank. So suppose if I have withdrawn 2 lakhs on 15th of July 15 and then after deposited 1 lakh, so I need to be careful that I cannot offer entire 2 lakhs, I mean, unless I again correlate that 1 lakh out of my earlier savings. Correct? Secondly, cash payment during the relevant period, that means that whatever payments I have made, like bank deposits or any other, you know, like accounted for expenses, they have to be offered as an expense here. Third, cash payment for the household expenses. They are very important category. One may be tempted to say that whatever I have withdrawn was with me and I have offered for tax assessment. But one has to keep it in mind that how the household expenditures have been met with. Now, one of my SSC very interesting told me that, sir, I am living with my father. So I am not required to maintain, I mean, pay for any household expenditure. So I told him, please be aware that your father should be able to furnish the evidence of having sufficient cash for the household of the family. Correct? So ultimately, some have to take the owner out of the family. Husband, wife, father, mother, I think there is no problem. But someone has to take the owners or responsibility for accounting for the household expenditure. If that is being taken care of, one can afford to go for that explanation here.
Every month I am withdrawing certain amount. Uh-huh. Is it not
necessary, because see,
every month I am a salaried person, I mean 50,000 a year a month. It is my bank
account.
Out of that 48 every month I am withdrawing.
It is? No, see, that's not telling you. Correct. See, that's not telling you. It depends on how so far it has been done. Let us say, for example, theoretically, one can very well say that my household expenditure are taken care of in some other way. You can explain the source of that household expenditure.
If you cannot explain that, otherwise
you might not have returned that. No, I think that is only if and buts. I think we have to go straight away with the explanation. What is the on accounting explanation? If you can afford to have another explanation or a proper explanation for the household expenditure, then you can go for that. Otherwise, you need to account for that expenses here as well. Correct? So, please understand that in case of the SSC not maintaining the regular books of account, it is possible or rather advisable to go even for the period prior to 1st 15. But make sure to do some rough working and then derive the figure and then account for it based on that particular criteria. And as he said, that keep into the mind that if you are regularly withdrawing, probably somebody can say that is your household or in the past. If you have already accounted for as a household expenditure somewhere or it has been debited in capital account in the past, then again it becomes very difficult for an individual to argue that it was only meant for my savings. Or, you know, which I ultimately hold on. So this is for the people. See, then you can do that, but what will happen? Then again the entire Pandora's box will open. Because what will happen? Then you have to go into the accounting year 15-16. Then again work out on FIFO basis. So how did you arrive at the balance on 31st March 16? So again you have to go to the formula that my balance of 31st March 16 was, you know, out of my cash withdrawal, was out of my cash sales. So what will happen? We are unnecessarily going into that explanation. In my opinion, when the cash on hand has already been reported prior to 8th November again, right? I am not talking of the cases where the returns have been revised subsequently. They all are again going to be put up for the scrutiny, I believe, later on. But assuming that, you know, it has been reported correctly, then it is safe for a person. No, when you say it was cash on hand, what does it mean? See, when you say it is your cash on hand, but assuming even if you take any balance accounting, you have cash on hand. Either there would be capital, or assuming that even if you have losses. But still, what would happen? The money is either out of your savings Because how would you have otherwise, you know, have that cash on hand? Correct? So that is, again I tell you, it is my personal opinion. You are at liberty to have your own opinion. But this appears to be me very logical, that once you have reported for capital, why should we go into unnecessary explanation for the prior fraud? Because that will be an area where otherwise they will get a chance to go into the accounting year 15-16 and make it open. Correct? So this is one of the reasons why I would say. And secondly, what has happened most of the time, most of the cases, the balance on 1st April 2016 would not be very high. I mean, ideally for the business people, considering the total quantum of the transaction, usually cash on hand would be a normal scenario where, you know, it would not be like equivalent to the entire cash withdrawal of the year. So you can safely take that figure and go ahead with the budget. However, if you feel it is advisable or, you know, in the benefit of the SSE to do that working, one can think of doing, then compare which one is a better, which one is more explainable. Then you can do that, correct? Or let's say theoretically there was no transaction in the earlier year. Only one withdrawal was there. And probably you can afford to report that. But then make sure that you mention the demand. Because theoretically, what can I do? The technology is very advanced, correct? We don't know what parameters, what triggers they are using. Say for example, somebody clicks only one figure. What is your cash on hand ever reported, ever reported? Then the only figure available will be 31st March 2016. Either on audit basis or return basis or whatever. So what can happen that they will take that figure safely? So probably many data-based analysis would be taking place considering that figure as well. Or it may happen, those who have a very high amount of cash on hand on 1st April 2016 already reported may not receive the notice at all because the profile is already matching. Correct? So that is why I am assuming or I am taking the figure of 1st April as a basis for that particular kind of the scenario.
So the question is, there are certain cases where you will have to travel beyond 1st April 2016,
correct,
more particularly in cases of working women who are having income from business or profession, but still have savings out of their households and other things which is not reflected in their books of accounts.
That is a scenario, as I told you, is a proprietary firm where the books of account of the firm are different and the individual books of account of the SSE are different. Working woman, you may do that, she is maintaining the books of work or any, but that is only for the business, not in the individual capacity, right? So it means that here you are exposing SSE to a situation where we are saying that the cash on hand, as per the reported balance, it was only pertaining to the firm, and the cash on hand with the individual was higher or different of that situation, can be explained, but make sure you have proper working and documentation. Because there also there will be some withdrawal from the firm to the proprietor or some money going to the proprietor to the firm. So you have to eliminate and take care of all these aspects into the mind. Talking of that situation, when you file the income tax return, in my opinion, usually the aggregate of the balance would have been reported. Technically, because if SSE is also doing a business, SSE can do 10 different business and can get every book business separately audited, can maintain the books of accounts separate for every business, correct? But when you file the return, it has to be an aggregate of all. So you know that we are preparing one Excel sheet where we say that business A, B, C, or individual, and then the last column will be reflected for the purpose of income tax return. And what has happened that from this year of March 17, wealth tax return is abolished. Otherwise, for the period prior to that, for the March 15, most of those who have already filed the wealth tax return would have in any case done that computation. So that figure would have reflected there also, because any case more than 50,000 was required to be reported liable as a wealth tax. So you have to keep all these factors into the mind, and depending upon the fact of the case, one can go. But yes, if it is advisable or justifiable to go beyond, no problem to go beyond that period as well. Now, Once you have the data, then we have to upload the data using the comma separated values. Here what will happen, we have to think of the situation like cash withdrawal out of the bank account. It can be one, two, or maximum as many banks you have. You need not give the detail date wise, because idea is that system will automatically give those details. Here I will suggest you to care of couple of items. Example 1, suppose if one has withdrawn a cash from the bank, normally what will happen, even say for the CA form, we will give a pure check to withdraw the cash. Now there can be two scenarios. One will mention self in the check, then we will sign on the back of the check. It will be recorded in the bank as a cash pay. Suppose if you give the check in the name of the pure, and don't sign on the back, because then you are not required to sign at the reverse of the check. Then what will happen, that particular amount of cash may be reported in the bank by the name of the person to whom it has been paid. So then again, a question arises whether SSC can claim that as a cash withdrawal or not, because probably bank would not report it as a cash withdrawal. So make sure you tally your cash withdrawal are also reported in the bank statement as a cash withdrawal, not by the name of the person, because technically they are not cash withdrawals. They are payment to the third party. Correct? So there can be a difference between the two. So that you have to keep into the mind while reporting the cash withdrawal out of the bank account. Another thing, cash withdrawal identifiable person with PAN number. As I told you, when you have the PAN number, it is the most reliable, or we can say the perfect way of reporting, right? Just make sure that the data is genuine and on what basis you have the PAN number. In fact, it may be a good idea to cross-verify at least some of the PAN numbers with the department website, you know. Because what has happened, suppose if one person reports the PAN number, but they are not matching with the name, then what has happened, automatically the second round of the query would come. So the PAN number, if reported, one has to ideally go and match it with the department website so that the name will match. Here also there can be one more trick. We all know that when you file the TDS return, for example, what is happening? The PAN number belongs to the SSC or individual, but the name of the payee may be firm. Correct? So what will happen? The PAN number may not match with the name of the payee, because the pay name may be different than the name of the account holder as per the PAN record. So here also one needs to be careful. Even in the case of the proprietorship form, maybe one can mention the name of the proprietor into the bracket, or mention the proprietor bracket name of the form, so that it will be straight away tallied with the data of the income tax records, you know. Because we know there are many cases where, you know, we heard that in the railway coach, when you travel, some people give the PAN number or that Tatkal reservation or e-ticket. So what is happening, in the chart, they display the name, age, male or female, city traveling, going, and the PAN number. So this entire chart, you know, was being sold as reported in the newspaper for some 50 rupees or 100 rupees. So the name and the PAN number may be available with many people and can be misused. In fact, I would go to the extent of saying that, please don't be soft. If we or our clients receive many notices of wrong or the false reporting done by the other people, and we have to be ready to disown or deny those transactions. In fact, for the cases we know that where some of the jewelers or many of the business people who have stolen the cases, right? We don't know. There is a possibility that somebody might have furnished the wrong PAN number, and some genuine person's PAN number might have been reported. So that he needs to disown. So this kind of litigation also will come in future. So we have to be very careful, and at least the reports which we make should not contain such kind of the false reporting. So better to validate the PAN number. And as I told you, you can take it up as a professional opportunity and convince the clients that it is in their own interest to get the verification of the data. And I believe most of the time when you do the TDS, already that type of exercise has been done. So nothing wrong on that part. Talking about the third scenario where identifier a person without PAN number. Here again, the care has to be taken that the details match the record available with them. Suppose if there is a cashless bill, then either the bill should mention the name, address and PIN code number. Correct? Suppose if I say that I have issued a cashless only with the name, Mr. XYZ, and then later on I say I have an address and the PIN code number, then what happens? What is the genuineness or what is the evidence that that address or PIN code was available with the SSE at the time of the transaction? Correct? So, as a charter accountant, as a professional, I would advise or I would suggest that make sure that whatever data is submitted, sort of a more intelligent exercise should be done by the charter accountant. So it is not a simple open and shut case, mind well. It can lead to a further problem or Pandora's box as well, right? And don't underestimate. Imagine the speed at which the things are going. In fact, today if you will see, probably 3rd February was the date when they started shooting the first round of the taxpayer. And I believe today again the reminders have started coming. Correct? Secondly, not only that, the same email has been keeping updating. Like I have received in one of the case, a notice of 10 lakhs on 3rd February, then 15 lakhs on 7th of February, because their data is dynamic. It keeps on updating. So don't do the blunder of reporting only what has been displayed. Rather, the reporting has to be done based on our own cash flow. And have the courage to differ or disagree or disown with the transactions which do not belong to the SSE. Be very clear, nothing wrong. It is the fundamental right of the SSE to deny the transactions which they have not undertaken. Right? Nobody can compel or force you to accept that unless there is some contrary evidence against you. Right? Having said this, one has to be careful that the data furnished by the SSE or the client has to be revalidated. And again, considering the larger interest of the nation, as we know, the call taken by the Honorable Prime Minister, Honorable Finance Minister, we as a professional, it is our duty, professional duty, to ensure that whatever replies we are submitting on the site or through our office using our IP address, at least those cases have to match with the reality. We should take a vow not to become a part of any of the misreporting or any of the false reporting or any of the reporting which is not believed to be correct. Right? So that is the call to be taken by the professional. Many a time, that is why some of the charter accountants we say that it's a matter of 5 minutes, simply report and go. I will always say don't do like this. Take it as an assignment. Have the courage of saying no to the client. Tell the client very clearly this is the way it has to be done. I am ready to do this thing and in this much detail, doesn't matter, you can charge him whatever you know reasonable or whatever you feel like, and the client doesn't agree, you should have courage to let him go. I think it's a high time profession has to come to that level. Because otherwise there has been a lot of issues raising the creditability of the charter account. And that is why this time we have seen in the budget provision for the penalty on the punishing of the listing by the charter accountant as well. So always make sure that whatever reply submitted through the office of a charter accountant or where the charter accountant involved, say many times there will be email correspondence or even telephonic conversation. Nowadays everything can be recorded. So don't be underestimate that is the oral communication and nobody can take the plea. Today, don't underestimate even the client. All the clients are very smart. In fact, I would say that most of the clients are smarter intelligent than a charter accountant. When it comes to their business, they know the things very well. They know what to tell, how to tell and to whom to tell. Correct? So we need to come out of that box, filter what is the truth and then only go for the report. Again, one more professional advice. my personal opinion, take a letter of authority from the client. Take a undertaking or a sort of a letter that whatever details have been furnished are true or based as per the knowledge. Take an extract of the cash book. If you are doing the regular audit, no problem. You have the access to the books of account. But if you are not doing the regular books of account or regular audit, you can afford to take that sort of working. At least take the cash book extract, print out, get it signed by the client, SSC, whatever working done by you, get it countersigned by the SSC and then furnish the details electronically. Correct? So this is the kind of the professional requirement in order to respond. Because see what will happen, the second round of query in my opinion would start very fast. Faster than you anticipate. In fact, it can happen very next day of your submit of the response. Technically it is possible. Yeah. See, that I'm telling you. That because they are taking that original date of that data entry. So what is happening? That I'm telling you. Suppose if you submit the response on 7th of February, it is quite possible that you can receive a second round of query on 8th of November. So be prepared for that round of query. And then what will happen? The more of the second round of query, you'll be facing intelligence and you'll be having proper explanation. So right at the beginning, if the exercise is done, then only it will be possible to reply or respond correctly. Don't add up haphazard manner. Don't go on the break or the guesswork. SSC will say, oh, I have already withdrawn. There are so many withdrawals in my bank account. Just reply it out of the bank withdrawal, right? But as a professional, see, we cannot compel or we cannot ask any SSC to do, what not to do. But if they ask us to do the needful, then we need to tell them that yes, this will be done only in this particular format. And that only will justify. Correct? So now here what has happened, received from unidentifiable person. I fully agree that here probably what has happened, the entire class of the SSCs, which were not intended to be covered, has been included. Say for example, restaurant business or some of the cash stores, malls, where they have a regular practice of deploying the cash on the very next working day. Correct? And many of them would not have deployed even a single SBL. I repeat, not even a single SBL, but still can receive this kind of notice. Because this is for the entire period of 9 November to 30 December. So the problem will have to be faced by them as well. Correct? So for them, it is necessary that they have to reply in a manner which will be accepted digitally to be convincing. Then and then only they will be eliminated from the first round. Otherwise, they also will be unnecessarily subject to the scrutiny in the second round. And we know that there have been, some increase in the powers of the authorities as well. There are some more trickle provisions of the penalty as well. So what will happen? Later on, it will be more, harsh, and the music to be faced will be in a very bad taste. So those fourth category is a very risky category. And probably it can include a class of people which is not unintended but can't help it. We hope that in the second round they would be eliminated.
Sir,
huh?
If I have deposited cash from sales of previous year,
no, but what are the cash on and the first upgrade?
Suppose I have cash on and 5
lakhs. So then out of 5 you can deposit. You can explain.
Then I can explain as the earlier
year
saying or
no.
As the receipt from identifiable person.
No, earlier you are saying because your 31st March cash on has already been reported. So we take it as a cut off date. Okay. Excuse me. Yeah. So here they are asking about the working date of the temple, where in my opinion they need to offer the explanation for the entire donation received probably date wise or even the receipt wise and prepare an Excel sheet and upload into the CSV format. Then when you upload the CSV format, we can download the template from the link. download CSV, then click on the template and provide a permanent CSV file, then update the data as per the heading provided, ensure that the field template is saved in the CSV format, click on the choose file to browse and select the updated CSV file. This will be sort of, you know, already given into the user guide. You can consider that. Then how to capture the data in the CSV file for the cash withdrawn out of the bank account.
Can you suggest minimum type of fees which we should charge from the client for this type of
fees? A very good question actually. In fact, I would love to answer. But as we know that, you know, we are in the city of Ahmedabad. And there are so many factors which will affect the fees. And this is not the forum. I am sure that everybody has a different ball game. And everyone's, you know, level of playing is a different. So depending upon, you know, one's standing and capability. Correct. Yeah, I mean you can take that as a basis. No problem. Right? Here projected that you can take the basis of whatever our ICI has recommended fees before you present, right? Even if you charge that, I think that would be sufficiently good enough to take care of the things, you know. In fact, honestly, I see very good future for the professional for at least another 5-10 years. Excuse me sir, just 1 minute we'll finish and then we'll start. We are almost on the verge of finishing the presentation, correct? So this, you know, we have to take care of IFSC code, account number. We know IFSC code we can get online, or the checkbook also has the IFSC code. Then, you know, cash received from the identifiable person. That they are not asking for the date, it is only the PAN number, name, nature, amount received. Without pay, again name, address, PIN code, nature, date is not required. Unidentifiable person. Now, again one thing, received from any other source, exempted income. We forgot to discuss one part. Suppose if there is agriculture income or any other income which is claimed to be exempt from tax. For that kind of income, probably the SSC needs to have a proper supporting and document. In the sense that, suppose the agricultural income, then copy of the 712 certificate, then copy of the certificate of the salati or the revenue record, that particular land is cultivable, what type of the crops can be taken, depending upon the hectares or the area of the land, you know, what is the quantum. And most important, the sale of the agricultural commodity into the agricultural produce marketing committee. Normally there is a sales receipt, you know, 10 rupees or 20 rupees would be the amount of the sales would be given. So that would be required document with the SSC. Based on that only one should report as annual income. And also remember to reduce the essential expenditure for agriculture. Like, you know, whatever you have done for harvesting, some fertilizer, chemical, pesticides, whatever used. So net only should be used for reporting as a agricultural income or a income exemption. Once you submit, it will be a validation button and do it. Now here again, after submitting, you can view the response submitted also. Correct? You can go transaction number wise. To view, it is advisable to take the printout, keep it on the record. Then again, verification of the cases. Some of the cases will be selected with a verification based on risk criteria. So the more detailed or proper answer we give, it will be easier to get eliminated in the very first round. Again, information will be communicated with a hyperlink in case of there is any further requirement. Then response will be assessed against the available information. And then again, you know, without need of the visiting. Now there are trigger penalty provisions. We all know that suppose if a person misses the deadline or if the explanation given does not match or does not hold good with the amount of the cash as per the record of the books, then SSC can be liable for a very ticker provision. So as a professional, we should always advise the client in case of any shortfall, one should think of options like going for a Prime Minister Garib Kalyan Yojana. Now we know that Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Yojana, PMGKY, what is that? We know that it provides for the tax at the rate of 50%, surcharge at the 33%, which is 9.9%, penalty at 10%, total tax liability of 49.9%, right? So in case of this, no deduction will be allowed in respect of any extra setup. Now, if there is a shortfall, if you work out 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 options, and it is still not matching with the amount of cash deposit, one has to go for the 7th option, which is the this Pradhan Mantri Garib Kalyan Yojana, right? And if you go for that, then at least to that extent, the inquiry will be dropped at this point of time only. So it is better, in case if it is intended, why NSL will go further and offer it right at this point of time. In fact, one of the reasons of this entire process making fast is this only. And in my opinion, the second draft also may be completed, even prior to 31st March. So that more and more SSCs who are unable to explain, we have the option to go for the particular scheme. Once the scheme is closed, then nobody can answer. That is very clear. Again, here we know that one particular provision is that mandatory deferred of not less than 35% of income in the zero interest bearing for 4 years. Now, even Reserve Bank of India has come out with the certain features of such deposits which are available on the RBI website, and you know, no premature withdrawal or whatever, blah blah blah, are there. So, one, if you decide to go for this Prime Minister, 49.9% with the tax, 25% will go to the interest-free deposit, and balance should be available to the SSC for use, and another 25% after the 4th year, right? Not declaring the black money into the scheme may be resulting into a total levy of 77.25% tax of penalty, and you know, as per the new section and all that. Now, again, in case of the Pradhan Mantri, this Yojana is not covering or not giving the protection to the FEMA or any of these prevention of money activity, narcotic, unlawful activity, corruption, Benami property transaction act, money laundering, or any other person where the special code has been operated. So please understand that this option is available only in case of the SSC, where he cannot be linked to any of these options. So obviously for a person holding a place of public, you know, in some institution or government or any place where there can be a possibility of public dealing, then one cannot go for this kind of scenario, because it can render him or exposed to the another set of prosecution under the any other act. So I think now this is the end of the presentation, and now we have the question of the session. And yeah, please.
Sir, what was the cash cleared in
IDF? Yes, very good question. You can straight away say, out of the earlier savings for that is the cash cleared in the IDF.
Repeat the question and give the answer.
See, the question is that what about a person who has declared under the IDF? So the person who has declared under the IDF will be reporting it as a in our earlier income of savings, because there is no other more appropriate column, and the remark column will say that this amount has been declared under the IDF scheme.
Sir,
not necessary. Not, you can use the date and the amount, so they will match with the rest.
Sir, point number.
Silently, but let there be silence for the benefit of those who are here. Say for example, on or after 9th November, cash has been...
Please repeat the question also.
Ah, okay.
The question is not known for answer.
Can you have the probability of that mice or something? Or, you know, what you can do? Okay, you please... can you go and give it to him? Yeah. Yeah.
Hello. So my question is, what about the cash deposited by debtors after 9/11 directly into the bank account, and they have deposited from different states?
Correct. See, okay. Here technically, first of all, the banks have asked for the letter of authority when accepting the SBN, right? Most of the banks we know that they did not accept the cash without having the signature of the account holder. In fact, they were matching the signature also. So number one, even if the debtor has done, and by mistake the bank is accepted, the account holder, the SSC, can disown the transaction. Number one. Here, because you have to report, he will report as a receipt from the person identifiable. In the remark, he will have to mention very clearly that the cash was deposited by this particular person without intimating that directly in the bank account without my authority. So what will happen? Those transactions are illegal. Please understand. And going into the legality, even the SSC can sue the customer, number one, for giving him the illegal notes, number one. Secondly, also for asking of the money, because the payment received was illegal. So he can say that you still owe to me. So practically you explain that received from the person identifiable without PAN number. If PAN number is available, you say with the PAN number, and also mention clearly that directly deposited by the particular customer out of the past cash sales and without authority. Correct? I think you are.
And if authority is given, then? If deposit authority is given,
then it means you have accepted for. That is your own cash.
Otherwise, can the government demand that money from your account? That is a more serious question in this case.
No, see, once it.
70 lakh tamara khata ma tamara debtor hai jama karaya. તમે ડિઝોન કરો
કરેક્ટ
બરાબર છે
કરેક્ટ
પ્રધાનમંત્રી કેસે લાવો
એબ્સોલ્યુટલી
યસ
કરેક્ટ કરેક્ટ યસ ટેકનિકલ વાત
એટલે લાસ્ટ મહારાજ
તો બેંક વન ફાઇન મોર્નિંગ યુ વિલ આસ્ક ધ બેંક એકાઉન્ટ ધેટ એમાઉન્ટ વિલ બી વેનિશ
તમારા
વન મિનિટ કેન સમબડી ગેટ
સર ઇન કેસ ઓફ ગિફ્ટ રિસીવ્ડ ઇન કેશ બાય એસએસસી ફ્રોમ હિઝ ગ્રાન્ડ મધર and thus gift deed is made between the demotage period.
See, that either of the person has to explain the SBN. Gift is valid, assuming that there is no problem, right? But suppose if the grandmother has given, then you know you have to give the details of the grandmother, who will say that yes, I have given the gift. And basically, no transaction can take place after 9th November, whether it's a gift or loan for anything, in the SBN. So the gift will have to be prior to 8th November only. Correct.
How can we buy the time?
No, no. I think there is no question of buying the time as of today. What will happen that there is a possibility that they will still keep on reminding. So you cannot expect a very strict or a very stringent action immediately, but with the passage of time, it will be definitely be a problem. Or what you can do, the best option is that you can submit the response and then again revalidate your response with further details.
Because they have given the date of 10 February.
Correct.
So, even if it's not possible to comply with all details, so how to reply? Interim reply can be given?
That's what I'm telling you. You can give, instead of obtaining the CSV file, simply mention that the cash sales from the unidentified person. Give the aggregate amount, right? Don't give the full detail if you cannot compile, right? But then later on, as soon as possible, try to compile the details and upload the same. You know, you can modify. As of today, you can modify. We don't know when that provision will be disabled.
One more question, sir. One of my client, lady client, had deposited 2,15,000. Now bank by mistake have given double same account is reported twice. So they have told that you have deposited 4,30,000.
Correct.
Now I have to disown one. So how to report that this is my out of own savings or something like
that? No, that is why in the very first column you will say that the amount deposited is only 2,15,000, right? Then you explain in 2,15,000 only. You don't need to explain another 2,15,000.
But so far as these ladies are concerned, household savings can...
No, that is a different question that you are explaining the 2,15,000, which can be out of your earlier savings, past withdrawal or whatever. In case as it is not made in the books of account, you have to go as back as you can, correlate with the cash withdrawal made before 7 years, 8 years.
Out of the husband?
No, then again, what is the transaction between the husband and wife? No, but the husband has to have that much amount of the cash available. Technically, someone has to see. Technically, someone has to accept the responsibility.
Return for 16,000 is not filed. How to return? First, I have to file the return, then I have to
balance.
See, I think some people have been taking it as a blessing, but not correctly.
He has not filed. Now, first I have to file the return, then I can.
Not necessarily.
That balance 31st March 16,000.
You should be confident of your books of account.
ऑक्टोबर महीना में सर्वे थयो हो ए वक्त डिस्क्लोज अमाउंट करी हो तो B7 में केस डिस्क्लोज बतावणी जे मना आवे
ना ना इट इज ओनली फॉर द प्रधानमंत्री गरीब कल्याण
योजना स्लैश में जे पंजे ऑक्टोबर में आपने डिस्क्लोज करी नाखेली जे सर्वे में
नो सी व्हाट इज हैपन दैट इट विल अकाउंट फॉर एज योर रेगुलर इनकम
अर्लियर इनकम એટલે કોલમ 1 માં
જ છે એન્ડ ધેન યુ મેન્શન ધ ડિટેલ હા
સંજય ભાઈ
संजय
भाईस आईडीएस 2016 one fellow has asked the questions, you have replied that it has to be shown as a
column number 1
case out of the earlier income or savings, but in your speech you have told that this is applicable for the 1/4/2016, but IDS was came thereafter.
Exactly, but what happened, because IDS does not specifically mention the period for which the cash was generated, correct? So it is an exceptional situation. And secondly, we all know that IDS will not be questioned because they have already offered it for explanation. So we can say, because there is no other appropriate criteria. See, we have to select only 1 out of 6, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Second, third, fourth, five, six is not appropriate, not applicable. So even by elimination, only one will be the scenario. And there they have mentioned that those cases they will be referring. So you can mention that IDS was opted for, and then it will be automatically eliminated.
That is true. But we can clarify by way of remark?
Haan, obviously. You have to mention in the remark.
Okay, thank you.
Haan.
Haan. Hello. Hello.
Even for the petrol pump or the exempted organization, they have to give the same calculation. Haan.
What is the rationale of hiding the details of prior to 8/11? So it would amount to counting the veins of the body, you see, and it is an impossible task. It is not expected from this. If we look it comprehensively, what is to be reported in B after this B2 to B6, that is an excess amount, then as on 8/11/2016. So my balance as on 8/11 is 5 lakh. If I have, say, deposited 14 lakh, then I have to report it in B2 to B6. If it is 5 lakh, then I have to report it only that I have, it is out of cash or a saving or earning.
Okay. I leave it up to you. You can do that. No problem. Hello. But that is not a proper explanation in my opinion.
Hello, sir.
Ah.
Hello. Hello.
My God, I'm here.
Suppose somebody has withdrawn 6 lakh rupees out of current year, and out of that he has deposited 3 lakh rupees. Then in CSV file, how much withdrawal we should show?
No, there is matter only in one row item. Give the bank account number, okay. IFSC code, and the total amount withdrawn.
Total amount withdrawn. No, not deposited.
And there in the remark column, you mention that from this period to this period.
Okay. And out of this was deposited that you
have. No. That in any case, total 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 okay. will come to the total. Can you give
the
I think I don't have the answer right now because it means you are accepting that you have entered into illegal transaction. Right? So then probably very difficult. You have to go to the coming some law and legal expert and find out what you are going to after 8th November, you have to take the first receipt. So go on the FIFO basis. Suppose if you have deposited only on 25th December, 10 lakhs of rupees legal not. You have your sales on 9th of November. So automatically it is presumed that 9th November legal not, 10th November legal not. So what will happen? Your 10 lakhs, you have to explain from 9th November, 10th November. However, if you have a better explanation, and if you think that you can justify, he ever reported to that. But scientifically, in terms of mathematically, accounting, legally, income tax and logically, you have to have some basis. And FIFO is a method of,
My question is that closing balance of 8-11 is to be find out by FIFO method.
Correct.
Because my cash book is a FIFO method.
That's what I'm telling you. But when you...
As and when I calculate my 8-11, thereafter I have to have the FIFO.
I think you have understood it correctly. Basically, on 8th November, you work on a report. From 9th November, you go for So, what about the
property sale before 8th November? If anybody is entering record or transaction, sale of jewelry or sale of any asset pertaining to this old denomination, that will be received.
In that scenario, what will happen that the details will have to be furnished. Suppose it's a sale of the property, then obviously the name, address, PAN number, everything would be available for the buyer. So you have to mention that detail, that sale of the property to such and such person for such and such amount. And the document would have been registered, so that is evidence.
Sir, secondly, it is not even practical to get the whatever be the cash balance with me as on 8th November or as on 1st April. I will be not maintaining it by denomination file. So So that is why I told you, let's keep 8th of November. In my opinion, everything is legal now. Correct? Only from 8th November, we need to bifurcate in two parts. So your balance from 8th November,
bifurcation process, we are starting right now, but whenever we go to normal cycle, we go to liquidity cash, and it is not necessary to the people write what they write cash deposit and focus to left. They are not writing this.
I beg to differ. After 8th of November, all the banks are specifically instituted, denomination wise, in case of the SPN, they have taken the letter as well. So it is not possible that you say that I don't have the denomination as detail.
That is fine from the bank's perspective. Whenever you are filling up the counter
for
whatever I
will need to pay. No, I disagree. Basically, it is the rest of the SSE, because after 8th of November, SSE has clearly authorized the bank, payslip has been filled and signed. So SSE cannot say that I am not aware how much SPN I have deposited.
The
payslip
has the 8th of November. The new currency was not in existence also.
Correct.
So whatever the balance is there on 8th of number, that is bound to be in the SBN only.
Nine. Hey, assuming that the sum is the 100 rupees, not some is the 50 rupees. Possible. Possible. Agree.
Correct.
Say that I have withdrawn from my partnership form. Give the PAN number of the partnership form. Day and the amount.
The PAN number of the only way
No, the partnership form has a different PAN number.
If I am a visitor
too? No, I think you are mixing up. Partnership form has a different PAN number. And the individual has a different PAN number.
If I am a visitor too, so that is A and the present, B and the present.
Then you can say out of the bank report. Then no problem. If it is the same PAN number, then you agree it. Then explain. Yeah.
Hello, sir.
Person has died. Okay. Yeah. No. In that case, the SPN has been deposited in the bank account, right? Then you can say that the same was received from the person who expired. Then you have to give the explanation. Be prepared that the person who died, when he died, number one, what was his capacity, whether you were filing the return, can it be justified that that person was having that much income? Suppose a person was filing the return of 5 lakhs of and then he has a cash for 3 lakhs in the locker.
Sir.
One more thing, it is criminal to maintain the cash in the locker. So always keep that point in the mind.
Sir. हाउसवाइफ को इन लोगों ने 2.5 लाख की छुट्टी दी थी सर शुरुआत में जब कैश डिपॉजिट हो रहे थे कंसिडरिंग दैट उसने हस्बैंड के अकाउंट में 2 लाख रुपये जमा किए हुए हैं उसके पर्सन सेविंग्स तो आइडेंटिफाइड पर्सन में भी पैन हम डाल सकते हैं ना उसमें
आई थिंक यू नो दैट इज समथिंग व्हिच यू नो लाइक मोर आउट ऑफ द फन बट लीगली यू हैव टू एक्सप्लेन द सोर्स
या द सोर्स द लिपो मेथड एंड ऑल यू से द सेम
I know, that is why I'm telling you it will be either you have to explain that how did the wife receive.
Okay.
If you say received from the wife.
If housewife is not filing return.
Then you be prepared that you know like explain that how did he receive, how did she receive and all that type of thing.
Okay.
You can have that creativity or imagination, but make sure it is justifiable and well documented.
Okay, saving. और सर अगर मैरिज फंक्शन के लिए अगर आपने कुछ टाइम कैश रिसीव किए हुए
यू हैव टू गिव द आइटम पर्सन वाइज लिस्ट ऑफ द चांदा रिसीव फोन डिटेल
हाँ
हाँ
That is a possibility, but we should not do that because we don't know which trigger can hit. See, this is not the only criteria.
They ask for the bank statement. They will say that you have withdrawn 5,000 every month.
Correct.
There is opening balance in January.
That's what I'm telling you. That you have to think from that way. Don't think this is the only response we are giving. Always be prepared. This is a summary. You know, like audit and balance, we give only one page. And secondly, when we sign only one page balance, you know, there may be billions of dollars of currency, right? But there is a supporting 100 pages trap balance and all working grouping. So similarly, the response may be a single page, but working at two. It is a risk of the SSE. If SSE has accepted SBM, you can. But provided your debtor also has to show that payment on 8th of November. No. So technically what happens, he needs to have a cash on hand on 8th of November.
Hello. Sir, the loan has been taken from NBFC, loan against gold, but the gold is not shown in books of accounts. What to do there? Gold is not shown in books of accounts.
Loan has been taken, yes. So, you are meaning to that you have taken the loan in cash from NBFC?
Yes.
In cash?
Yes.
You have taken from NBFC?
Yes.
So, you can tell that the cash is out of the loan taken from NBFC?
Yes.
And be prepared for the paying taxes on the gold, not the store. Yeah. Maybe electronically directly it will go to that PAN number of the SSE. Without PAN, you know, then probably on random basis they can issue the letter. But I think it is a very difficult time consuming. But then you have to account for it. provision will it's a, and they have the powers to that.
Hello.
No, that's only code for the last meter of one letter. Or so only 5 letters. Don't give the date one. Correct. You have to give only for 5 days. So you, they are not asking for the date. They are asking for the bank account number. So that you say that the cash depositor is out of the cash withdrawal on 24 date from 24 bank. So out of 2 lakhs, 1 lakh depositor. Only 5 lakhs. So you mention all the 3 instances of 2 lakhs of withdrawal. And say that out of the cash withdrawal of 6 lakhs, 5 lakhs have been deposited. Yes. No, but then you write in the last instance one only, and the remark you mention out of the window of 2 lakhs.
Thank you, sir. And now I think the informal session can still go on.
Thank you, sir.